Sabbath peace.
Sabbath peace.
It's another opportunity for us to come together and hear and learn of the word of truth that's given to us by the Most High God. All honor goes to the Father through the Son, whose name is Yahushua. In him lies the only hope for salvation. It is obtained by grace through faith, not of works, lest anyone should boast, and given freely as a gift to all who obey him. We understand if you do not obey him, it is made manifest or made obvious that you do not believe. In this state, you should expect no good thing from the Most High. However, anything that you do get, whether it be a gift of tongues, a gift of prophecy, or any supernatural experience that you may have, it can and it will be used against you in the day of judgment. With that said, peace to the saints that are in the room, the saints that couldn't make it, the saints watching in. No peace to the wicked. The only thing we say to them is repent that they might live. All right? Since the day of a trumpet is among us, we will talk a little bit about the day of trumpets. So we'll start off with, what should we start off with, actually? What would become appropriate for a feast?
For a feast? You take, go start the wilderness, or at least Leviticus 23, explaining it.
All right, let's go to Leviticus. Yeah, I guess that's a simple way to do it. Let's go to Leviticus chapter 23. Zahara, go put that belt up. Stop playing, or I'll whoop you for real. This is Leviticus chapter 23, verse 23. Oh, hi. Leviticus chapter 23, verse 23.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, in the first day of the month,
on the first day of the seventh month,
shall ye have a Sabbath, a memorial of blowing of trumpets, convocation.
Right? So this was made to be unto us a Sabbath, and it was a memorial, a blowing of trumpets. Right? And it was going to be a holy convocation. In other words, a sacred assembly. It's when we come together, we gather together in a set-apart way for the Most High God, right? So it was a Sabbath to us. It was a memorial, a blowing of trumpets. It was a sacred assembly. What else?
You shall do no servile work therein, but you shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord.
All right, so it was a day of rest, and then it gave us sacrifices to do. What else?
And the Lord spake to Moses, saying, also on the 10th day of this seventh month.
Oh, we don't have to keep going. I thought it was going to list out the sacrifices there. Right, so we had those sacrifices, but it was a memorial of blowing the trumpets. Right, a lot of people don't realize, and actually we talked about it when we went over Revelation. We talked about the trumpets that would blow and some of the things that would happen as a result. But there were seven trumpets that were in Revelation. Right, seven different trumpets, and after each trumpet, some other event happened, something happened. All right, so we know there will be trumpets. A lot of the feasts that we look at, they are not just a memorial for things that have happened, but they're also a testimony of things that will happen. That's what we saw with Passover. That's what we saw with the week of unleavened bread. That's what we saw with the first fruit sheaf, the sheaf waving, right, when it comes to Yahushua. All right? Grab Zechariah for me. Let's talk about some trumpets a little bit. This is Zechariah chapter 9, verse 11. Zahar. Can you bring me a little bit of water? Thank you, son. Bring two more, please. Thank you, son. It's Zechariah chapter 9, verse 11.
As for thee also, by the blood of your covenant, I have sent forth your prisoners out of the pit, wherein is no water. Mm-hmm. Turn ye to the stronghold, ye prisoners of hope. Even today do I declare that I will render double unto you.
Right? He said, even today, I'm going to render double. He's talking about us. Right? He said, start all over. He said, as for thee.
As for thee also, by the blood of thy covenant.
He said, as for thee also, by the blood of thy covenant. He's going to do what?
I have sent forth thy prisoners out of the pit wherein is no water.
That's talking about the resurrection. Right? He said he's going to send us forth out of the pit by the blood of our covenant. Talking about Yahushua. Right? So we see this is talking about end times. Watch what it keep going and say.
Turn ye to the stronghold, ye prisoners of hope.
Uh-huh.
Even today do I declare that I will render double unto you.
Mm-hmm.
Which I have been Judah for me, filled the bow with Ephraim, and raised up your sons, O Zion, against your sons, O Greece.
All right. He said it's going to be a time where the Hebrews are going to be against the people of Yavon. Right? What we know as the Grecians. All right. Let's keep going.
And made thee as the sword of a mighty man.
Uh-huh.
And the Lord shall be seen over them, and his sorrow shall go forth as the lightning. And his arrow shall go forth as the lightning, and the Lord God shall blow the trumpet, and shall go with whirlwinds to the south.
And the Most High God is going to end up blowing the trumpet. And what's going to happen after that?
And shall go with whirlwinds of the south.
Watch what happens next.
The Lord of hosts shall defend them, and they shall devour and subdue with sling stones, and they shall drink and make a noise as through wine, and they shall be filled like bowls, and as the corners of the altar. And the Lord their God shall save them in that day as the flock of his people, for they shall be as the stones of a crown,
mm-hmm.
lifted up as an ensign upon his land. For how great is his goodness, and how great is his beauty.
All right, so we look at it, why would the trumpet blow? He said he's going to blow the trumpet. He talking about, man, I'm going to go ahead and bend Judah. Now I'm going to load Ephraim into it like an arrow. I'm going to shoot that thing. Oh, that thing going to come like lightning. Yeah, after that, then he's going to blow the trumpet. And he's going to go forth like the whirlwind from the south. And then what did he say next? He said, and then I'm going to defend him. Right? He's talking about the trumpet being war. He's letting us know that's a warning. He's letting us know like something's about to happen. Everybody need to be on alert. It's an alarm. Right? Go to Amos for me. Amos chapter 9. He's going to shoot through this real quick. This is Amos chapter 9, verse 11. These wicked people in the world don't know what they get into. Most High God come back here, you're going to start letting off these trumpets. People don't know what they're getting into. A lot of these people think they know God, thinking just believe. I mean, as long as you, I know what God I'm fighting for. You don't know nothing. You a sinner. You trying to impress me for. Right? You ever had them people, they get to talking like that because you come around, they know, you know what I'm saying, they know what you about. They get to run in their mouth, you know what I'm saying? Oh, well, you know, I may not be perfect, but I still love God. And I do this all myself. I was like, man, what you trying to impress me for? I ain't got nothing to say to you. I ain't about to confirm what you're talking about, make you feel good. I ain't got nothing. I ain't about to tell you a sinner either. I'm gonna leave you alone. You know what I'm saying? You ain't got nothing to do with nothing I'm talking about. You know what I'm saying? Just serve God if you're gonna serve him. If you're not gonna serve him, then don't serve him. Don't try to pretend like you in the middle somewhere. Ain't no middle ground. You say, yeah, spew your butt out. That trumpet sound, we gotta move when it comes. This is Amos chapter 9, verse 11.
In that day will I raise up the tabernacle of David that is fallen.
He said, in that day, right? So whenever, you know, you hear in that day, a lot of times that's talking about end time, right? This is too. He said he's going to raise up the tabernacle of who?
David that is fallen.
Uh-huh.
And close up the breaches thereof, and I will raise up his ruins and will build it as in the days of old.
Mm.
That they may possess the remnant of Edom and of all the heathen which are called by my name, says the Lord that does this.
Right? So understand what the Most High God just said. He said he's going to raise up the tabernacles of David. In other words, Judah, right? Israel. That's what David ruled over. All right, so he's going to raise up the tabernacles of David. Then after that, he said that we're going to possess the heathens, right? So then he said the Gentiles is going to be who we possess after that. What else?
Behold, the days come, says the Lord, that the plowman shall overtake the reaper.
Uh-oh.
And the treader of grapes, him that sown seed.
Mm-hmm.
And the mountains shall drop sweet wine, and all the hills shall melt.
Mm-hmm.
And I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel, and they shall build the way cities and inhabit them.
Right? So he said, then we're going to build the way cities and inhabit them after all these calamities fall. Right? What else?
They shall plant vineyards and drink the wine thereof. They shall also make gardens and food of them.
So now I just want y'all to understand, when the book is telling us about the things that's going to happen in the future, a lot of us think, you know, we're just going to waltz in there. Everything going to grow by itself. It's just going to be a perfect place. No, no, no. Man said, your butt will still be working. He said, you're going to plant vineyards. What else?
And I will bring again the captivity of Israel, and they shall build the way cities and inhabit them. And they shall plant vineyards and drink the wine thereof. They shall also make gardens and eat the fruit of them.
All right? He said, what you eat, you're going to grow it. That's going to be your stuff. He said, and you got to build it back up. Right? Keep going.
And I will plant them upon their land, and they shall no more be pulled up out of their land, which I have given them, says the Lord thy God.
Most High God said, next time we get put there, we ain't never leaving it again. That's why he got to weed us out. We read about it because, you know, when we're going through Revelations, we read about it that he got to weed the people out. He said, we're going to go into the wilderness. Then at that time, he's going to get the rebels up out of there. Because if they got to the land first, he'd end up breaking his promise if he removed them. So he had to remove them. When we on our highway to holiness, he said, nobody can cross that thing that ain't holy. Right? Because he had to remove them on the way there. If you get there, he ended up breaking a promise. Like, nah, you a rebel. You got to go. Well, I already promised that once I put you here, you will never leave again. Right? Keep going. Most High God can outthink y'all easily. Easily is what he's looking at. He's like, man, y'all ain't thinking on my level. All of us, we sitting here trying to think on this level. He'll make a fool out of us.
That's the end of the chapter.
Oh, that's it?
Mm-hmm.
Grab Nehemiah. Nehemiah 4. I'm gonna shoot through this real quick. In Nehemiah chapter 4.
But it came to pass that when Sanballat heard that we builded the wall, he was wroth and took great indignation and mocked the Jews.
Jump down in verse 7.
But it came to pass that when Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabians and the Ammonites and the Ashdodites heard that the wall of Jerusalem was made up.
We've been through this before. That's why we went to Nehemiah. It's not the first time. Amos said that we're going to go back into the land and we're going to rebuild it up. Remember, everything that we look at, we want to be able to go backwards and be like, okay, is there any foundation for this or is this brand new? A lot of times it's not brand new. A lot of times the Most High God has given us something to go off of. That's what it's all about for us, right? So if we go back, we look at it, we got to look at Nehemiah. He went back into the land. He had to rebuild the waste. You know what I'm saying? Babylon tore our stuff up. They ran all through our stuff, right? So he had to rebuild the ways. He had to get everything back going. This is Nehemiah. Keep going. It's Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 8.
And that the breaches began to be stopped. Then they were very
wrong. The breaches are holes or breaking points. Something where something, you know what I'm saying, it got something. You would think of a breach. If I got a whole wall, it's made for nobody to be able to come in. A breach would just mean there's a way for somebody to come in somewhere where it's not supposed to come in. Right, so he said the breaches was stopped.
Then they were very wroth.
Uh-huh.
And conspired all of them together to come and to fight against Jerusalem and to hinder it.
Right, so they heard about us rebuilding our stuff, and the people all came to fight against us. The Gentiles all came to. Does that sound familiar or no? Right, we are talking about Revelation. We saw the same thing. We went into our land, and then all nations gathered against us. Right, we've been through these things before on a much smaller scale, maybe. But nevertheless, it gives us an idea of what we have, what we need to look forward to, and how we need to look to God to save us. Watch what Nehemiah said. Keep going.
Nevertheless, we made our prayer unto our God and set.
You made our prayer to who?
Unto our God.
Okay.
And set a watch against them day and night because of them.
Right? So they set up a watch. And you know what they did in the watch? You had somebody looking for trouble to come. If they saw trouble, I mean, what would they do? They start yelling.
And blow the trumpet.
You're going to blow the trumpet if you see trouble. Trouble start breaking out, you're going to end up blowing the trumpet. That's why you got to watch. Jump on down. We can skip a little bit. Go to verse 17.
they which build it on the wall, and they that bear burdens with those that laid it, everyone with every one of his hands wrought in the work, and with the other hand held a weapon.
Right? So we are sitting there building. One of us, we had our weapon on one hand. And the other hand, we just stacking bricks. You know what I'm saying? Or whatever we are stacking. You know what I'm saying? We are just stacking, you know what I'm saying? Just stacking bricks. Our weapon in our other hand, we can only work with one hand because we looking like somebody got to watch. These people might show up. And if they show up, we got to fight. So, but we know what we know the job that the Most High God commissioned for us. And we have a love for our city. And we happy to be back in our own land. But we sitting here trying to put everything back together. Got a weapon in one hand. We building with the other hand. Everybody working together. Everybody ready to fight at the same time. Watch this.
For the builders, everyone had his sword girded by his side, and so builded.
Uh-huh.
And he that sounded the trumpet was by me.
He that did what?
Sounded the trumpet was by me.
You see that trumpet gonna sound. And why you think they sounded it? Because trouble is on the way. You got somebody that's watching. When we had this memorial trumpet, it's letting these people know it's time for war. It's time for the Most High God to get with it. All right? Keep going.
And I said unto the nobles, unto the rulers, unto the rest of the people, the work is great and large, and we are separated upon the wall, one far from another.
Uh-huh.
In what place, therefore, ye hear the sound of the trumpet, restore ye here unto us. Our God shall fight for us.
Uh-huh.
So we labored in the work, and half of them held the spears from the rising of the morning till the stars appeared.
Right.
Likewise, at the same time, I said unto the people, let everyone with his servant lodge within Jerusalem.
You don't think we're going to be ready to fight? Y'all missed what he said, but you don't think we're going to be ready to fight? All of us going to be ready to fight. We're going to be ready to defend. When we get back over there, we're going to be ready to defend our place, our home, right? Where we finally get back to. We're going to be shaking, scared, nervous. You know what I'm saying? But notice what he said. Go back to verse, what was that, 20?
In what place, therefore, you hear the sound of the trumpet, restore ye here unto us. Our God shall fight for us.
He said, our God shall fight for us. That's going to be the difference. And that's what's described when we read Revelation. The Most High God comes and he fights. He said his vesture was dipped in blood. Everybody else's, oh, they white. Everybody else just clean. That's because we didn't help. He out there getting himself dirty. We didn't end up helping. We didn't need to help. All right? So when the trumpet blow, for us, it's saying it's time for war. These people done. These people going to hear the trumpet. They ain't going to know what they listening to because they don't know the book. They going to think something else going on because they don't know the book. They not going to understand what's coming. You see it all the time in Revelation. They don't know enough about God to even turn from the sins that they're doing. They don't know a sin. They ain't going to know. They were talking about, I was sitting around at my mom's house today, and they were talking about some guy who had crosses cut into his beard. You know what I'm saying? Like, he got to design his beard, I guess, and he had crosses in it. And they asked him about it, and he was like, yeah, I just got to keep these demons away any way I can. That's how you do it, huh? They have no idea. So Most High God whooping they butt through life. The ones that he wants to turn. Ones that he wants to turn, whooping they darn butt through life. And they don't realize it's because of their actions. You got an idol just carved into your face. For what? And you keep reshaping it up to do the same thing? You think the Most High God just going to sit around and just be like, okay, nah, you all right. You saved anyway. I know what you meant. I knew your heart was good. How you know your heart was good when he told you that anything that come from a man come from his heart? If it's evil come from you, what that say about your heart? You wicked. These people don't care to learn, though. Grab 1 Corinthians. We trying to blow the trumpet. That's what we do every week. Every week, we trying to blow the trumpet. They don't know what they're listening for, though. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 6. Watch what Paul says. Now, Paul talking about tongues right here. Well, he make a good point. Watch this. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 6.
Now, brethren, if I come unto you speaking with tongues, what shall I profit you, except I shall speak to you either by revelation or by knowledge, or by prophesying or by doctrine, and even things without life giving sound, whether pipe or harp, except they give a distinction in the sounds, how shall it be known what is piped or harped?
Right? So he's talking about musical instruments. He's saying, like, whether it's a pipe or it's a harp. You know what I'm saying? Whether it's a blowing instrument or whether it's a harp. You know what I'm saying? A string instrument. You know what I'm saying? He said, either one, he said, how do you know that it's that instrument unless it gives a distinct sound? If you had a pipe that sounds like a harp, you're going to think, the pipe is a harp. If they both sound exactly the same, by hearing it, you won't know which instrument it is. He said, the reason why we know these instruments to be different is because they give a distinct sound. Watch what he say next.
For if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, who shall prepare
himself? If the trumpet gives
an
uncertain sound, people ain't going to dance.
Who shall prepare himself to the battle?
What are you doing talking about dancing when you talk about a trumpet? He said, you hear the trumpet, that's wartime. And if you don't hear it right, then how do you know to prepare yourself for the battle? That's going to be the problem with all these people. That trumpet going to blow, they ain't going to understand what they're listening to. They're not going to hear it right. Right? We blow the trumpet every single week, metaphorically. Right? Every single week we out here sounding the alarm, telling people you need to turn away from sin. They're not hearing it, though. How they going to know to prepare for battle? They ain't going to war with us. They're going to war with the Most High God. That's something you might want to prepare for. Guess not. Ezekiel chapter 32, 33. Ezekiel chapter
33.
Ezekiel chapter 33, give me verse, what verse 1 say?
Again, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, speak to the children of your people, and say unto them, will I bring the sword upon the land?
Yeah, go ahead. This is Ezekiel chapter 33, verse 1.
Again, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, speak unto the children of your people, and say unto them, when I bring the sword upon a land, if the people of the land take a man of their coast and set him for their watchman.
Here you go, watchman again. Let's see.
If when he sees the sword come upon the land and he blow the trumpet and warn the people, then whosoever hears the sound of the trumpet and takes not warning, if the sword come and take him away, his blood shall be upon his own head. He heard the sound of the trumpet and took not warning, his blood shall be upon him. For he that takes warning shall deliver his soul.
Right, so he said, if I set a watchman, and this watchman sees that the sword is coming upon the land, he said, all he got to do is blow the trumpet. He said, now the people that hear it, now it's on them. If they hear the trumpet and they protect themselves, then good. But if they don't protect themselves, then the blood is on their own hand. They heard the trumpet and they chose not to do anything with it. Right? Let's hear the next scenario here.
But if the watchmen see the sword come and blow not the trumpet, and the people be not warned, if the sword come and take any person from among them, he is taken away in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at the watchman's hand.
All right? He said, now, if I set up this watchman, and he decides not to blow the trumpet, and he misses the fact that the sword is coming upon the land, now anybody who gets attacked, the blood is on his hand. Because he is designated to be the watchman, the person that looks over and warns the people that the war is coming. We got a watchman, and I guarantee you that trumpet gonna blow. He ain't missing it. So at that point, it's up to the people. It's up to the people. Are you gonna take up arms or not? Are you gonna protect yourself or not? Are you gonna keep winning alone in life like you didn't hear the trumpet? All right? It's Matthew chapter 5, verse 1.
seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Mm-hmm. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Mm-hmm. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Mm-hmm. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Mm-hmm. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
All these people heard the trumpet. Everybody he just named there, those are people that heard the trumpet. Let's keep going.
Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Mm-hmm. Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? Mm-hmm. It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but it's on a candlestick, and it gives light unto all that are in the house. Mm-hmm. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven.
That's what is important for us. It's the fact that we are the light of the world, right? Those of us who obey the commandments of the Most High God through Yahushua, right? We are the light of the world. So it's important that we are seen, because by us being seen, it gives other people direction. It gives other people inspiration. It allows them to see Yahushua in a way that maybe they would not have seen him had we not been represented. We're representations of him. So if we misrepresent him, that becomes on us. Right? That's how we blow the trumpet a little bit in our own lives. All right? Blowing the trumpet is not necessarily for everybody to walk around saying, everybody turn from sin, this, that, and that. That's not necessarily what you're supposed to do. There's some people that will have that position. But I can tell you one thing, that everybody that's a child of God, everybody has this one position. Obey him. By doing that, you become a light. And as being that light, then it allows people to see. It's the same thing that we have going on. I was talking to my wife, I was talking to Tasha. And we were talking about Christmas and all these different holidays that we used to celebrate. And kind of the difference of the things that we celebrate now. It's like, it just don't feel like, you know what I'm saying? You have Day of Trumpets, you have Passover. It's just like the excitement and everything. It just don't feel like, you know what I'm saying, like it did when Christmas and everything. And we know all that stuff is wrong, but it still don't feel the same. It's not like the same festive type of time.
Because you're the only person celebrating it.
Exactly. You're the only one doing it. Right? But, I mean, just imagine if we had our Hebrew brother, everybody came on the same day, and they came into town, and it was just like a big thing. Now it becomes festive because now you have everybody representing the same thing. Right? So when we come across Christmas, what does it do? It angers us because now we have to see all this stuff that's against what we believe.
It's so annoying too.
Right? And that happens because there's a lot of people representing something that we disagree with. And vice versa, there's not a lot of people representing the things that we do agree with. Right? The same thing about the light. When you're a light, it makes it easier for people. Right now, it's four of us. Right? So people look, and it's like, that little light is just, you know, just flickering over there. Easy to ignore. I'm going to keep walking. Right? I'm going to keep doing what I do. As long as we continue to build it, or the Most High God continues to build it, now that light becomes something that you can't ignore. Right? But now with the light being so small, it's even more important that each one of us represents the Most High God to make sure we shine brightly. Otherwise, it gives people no direction, no filter, nothing to go to. Right? And that's what we have to do. That's sounding the trumpet for us. Right? Just making sure that we obey God. We consistently and constantly represent the Most High God and give him a representation that people can focus on. Right? With the knowledge that not everybody going to go with it. Right? This is John chapter 16. John chapter 3, verse 16. I lied. You know, you can't start at 16. Not with no Christian. You got to start at 14. It's John chapter 3, verse 14.
And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up.
He said, just like Moses lifted up a serpent in the wilderness, that's the same way that the Son of Man gonna have to be lifted up. Remember that. Watch this.
That whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life.
Mm-hmm.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life.
So he's saying God loved the world in the same way that he loved the Israelites when Moses lifted up the serpent so that they'll be healed. Right? Very important. He said God so loved the world that he gave his Son to give his life. That anybody that end up believing in him, they'll have everlasting life. Watch this. That sound real good. Keep going.
For God sent not his own Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
Most like God didn't send Yahushua in here to condemn the world, to tell everybody that they sinners and they doing it wrong and they're going to end up going to hell. He didn't send them for that purpose. What purpose? He sent them so that he can give people life. All right? Let's hear the next verse, though.
He that believes on him is not condemned. But he that believes not is condemned already.
He's like, y'all but was already condemned. What are you going to tell him to condemn the world for? Mm-hmm. Hell was already condemned. We already had something that condemned us. What condemned us?
The law.
The law came to condemn us. He said that was quick work. You know what I'm saying? He already laid that foundation. Y'all been condemned. That ain't even nothing. What I'm going to send somebody else to tell y'all wrong for? I've been telling y'all wrong for years. Right? He said, I came to give y'all opportunity. Let's see. Keep going.
That believes not is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God.
He said, you don't believe in him, you're going to be condemned. People are like, oh, well, I believe. I mean, I just believe. Let's keep going. Because, you know, it's always important that the Most High God cover himself. He do it every time. He don't cover himself. You stop at John 3:16, you might think you got something. You know what I'm saying? You keep reading a little bit. Oh, he didn't come to condemn. That thing make you feel all tingly on the side. See, I knew it. I mean, I feel wrong sometimes. Ain't nothing but the devil. Because God didn't come to condemn. Then he said, you condemned already? You're like, I don't really get that, but it don't matter because I believe. He said, anybody who believes, they not condemned. Okay, keep reading.
And this is the condemnation.
This is the condemnation. So if you don't believe, this is the condemnation.
That light has come into the world and men love darkness rather than the light because their deeds were evil.
Uh-oh. He said, light's coming to the world. And men love darkness rather than they love light because their deeds are evil. The things that you do are evil. So when we become lights, little lights that shine, we're sitting on a hill where it's just like lighting a candle and trying to put it underneath your couch or something. He said you just don't do that because you want a light to be seen. You want a light to shed light, right? So when we become little lights, there's a lot of people that's not going to rock with that. A lot of people that's not going to rock with it. Because their deeds are evil. They don't want to change their life. They don't want to change their behavior. But that makes us just like the watchman. If the watchman sounds the trumpet and somebody decides, I'm not going to take up arms. I'm not going to protect myself. I'm not going to run. I'm not going to escape. Then guess what? The blood is on their hand. Right? We just have to do our part. Otherwise, the blood would be on us. Right? This is, where do we leave off? Where were we at before that? Matthew. This is Matthew, what verse we leave off? Matthew chapter 5, verse what?
16.
This is Matthew chapter 5, verse 16. It's Matthew chapter 5, verse 16.
Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven.
Uh-huh.
Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets.
He said, don't think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets.
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
Uh-huh.
For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
Okay.
Whosoever therefore shall break one of the least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven.
Uh-huh.
But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven.
Mm-hmm.
For I say unto you that except your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven.
But why do we acknowledge these feasts? He said, the ones who do these things will be great in the kingdom. Grab Matthew 11, just so we can have some perspective. He said, the ones who do these things will be great in the kingdom. The ones who teach people to break them, though, you're going to be least in the kingdom. Now, I want to be fair, because right now I want to promote the feast days. But I don't, at the same time, in promoting the feast days, want to give an inaccurate message. So if you least in the kingdom, Matthew 11:11, let's see what that's like.
Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there has not risen a greater than John the Baptist.
John the Baptist, in other words, the greatest man ever, right? Let's hear about it.
Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he.
He said, but if you least in the kingdom of heaven, you better than John the Baptist. Right? So being least in the kingdom of heaven, well, that ain't a bad deal. Right? No, it's not exactly a bad deal. But at the same time, the man has given us the opportunity to be great in the kingdom. So what I look like ignoring the feast, ignoring the Sabbath, right? Ignoring the things that he gave us for us to be healthy. Ignoring the love that he commanded us for our brother. The standards, not charging each other interest, right? Looking after each other's freedom, right? These are things, I mean, technically, just by obeying Yahushua, you technically could get away with charging your brother interest. Right? You can't get away with that under the law. Right? You're not going to get away with that under the law. You hold yourself to the standard of the law. Now you love your brother more perfectly. Right? Which makes you great because now you're serving your brother. The ones who serve the least among us will be great. That's how it goes. If I keep the law, I'm going to be serving my brother. Which is going to get me and make me great inside of the kingdom. And part of that is the feast. Part of that is our memorials, the memorial of trumpets, right? And that's what we look at now. This is Ezekiel 34. Ezekiel chapter 34, verse 17.
And as for you, O my flock, thus says the Lord God, behold, I judge between cattle and cattle, mm-hmm. between the rams and the goats and the he-goats. Seems it a small thing unto you that you have eaten up the good pasture, but you tread down with your feet the residue of your pastures and to have drunk of the deep waters, but you must foul the residue with your feet.
Right? He says, I judge between cattle and cattle. Right? He said, I'm trying to separate cattle versus cattle. He said, what you think is a small thing that you get the good and you leave people with this garbage? Talking about these pastors and these leaders and these teachers and these people that leave us with garbage. These people, I mean, just even away from the pastors who definitely 100% deserve a little bit of blame. But if you just look at the leaders overall of our people, you got the leaders of the NAACP that's suing President Trump over DACA. NAACP, what that stand for? National African
National Achievement Advancement of Colored People, something like that.
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
I thought it was National African American something.
National Advancement National Achievement Advancement of Colored People, something like that. But it's I know it's Advancement of Colored People.
They probably changed it.
Probably.
Why in the world are you suing the president over Mexicans when we got the highest health problems in the country, the worst medical care in the country? We have we're the poorest group of people in the country, by and large. The average family is only worth, the black family is only worth $1,700 in wealth. Like, that's insane. $1,700 in wealth. That's all you got to your name. If you sold everything and paid off all your debts, the average person would have $1,700. Why are we fighting for DACA? This is the choices of our leadership, though. So-called leadership. Right? This is what they try to lead us towards. They have no idea. They get the good. They get all these good things. They families taken care of. They get to rub shoulders with these rich politicians. They get everything good. And then they give us nothing. They don't fight for it. They have the Congressional Black Caucus, right? It's a group of congressmen that are supposed to come together and seek ways to benefit black communities. What have y'all ever heard anything from them? Right now, I can guarantee you, they're fighting for Mexicans right now. Mexicans and other immigrants. What sense does it make that the National Congressional Black Caucus, or whatever it's called, is out here screaming about DACA? The people are called dreamers. That's what they call them. Dreamers. Where do you think they got that from? It was a bill that they made called the Dream Act, right? And that was supposed to be for illegal immigrants to help them become citizens. Right? They called it the Dream Act. I wonder why. I wonder what they got that from.
Dr. King.
Martin Luther King. And then that now, even though that Dream Act never got passed, right? That's why you got DACA. So what happened is they tried to get the Dream Act through. Dream Act didn't work. That thing got canceled. Nobody messed with it. Then all of a sudden, President Obama was like, okay, well, in the meantime, you know what I'm saying? I'm going to make this executive order. That way a law don't got to get passed. And for a temporary period of time, the illegal immigrants, under these circumstances, are going to be all right. They're going to be good. You know what I'm saying? Y'all leave them alone for a limited period of time. Right? So that's what DACA is. So President Obama put that in place. He didn't put a whole lot in place for black people. That's a whole other story. Whatever. President Obama put that in place. He look out for the illegal immigrants that are here. Right? So now, even though the bill did not get passed, now they're called dreamers. Bill didn't get passed. They called dreamers. They bite off at everything that we have. Everything that we did, everything that we fought for, they come in at the end of it. We still haven't realized the dream that Martin Luther King was talking about. Right? But they come in on the back of it, and they use it, and now all of our people are fighting for them. When we still haven't even got what we started. And now if you speak against it, I'm racist now. I'm heartless. These kids came, they got brought over here as kids, right? They got brought over here as kids from another country. It's not right to send them. Why is it not right to send them back to their country? If it's a problem to send them back to their country, let's just say if I think it's wrong that they live in these terrible conditions, right? These terrible conditions in their country. Well, then let's make America do something about that. Let's protest America and say, you know what? Talk to Mexico. Let's take over Mexico. Let's do whatever we have to do to make sure that we raise the conditions. Let's just do it flat on. But let's not say people can illegally come here, take jobs from my people, and then now my people got to fight for them to have better conditions in this country. When down south, you got people that have what we listen to? Hookworm. They got hookworm because they ain't got the proper sewage lines, sanitation lines. So they sitting there, they walking around in their own poop in their yard. But now we worried about people in Mexico. Our leadership, supposed leadership. It's what the Most High God talking about. He said, do you think it's a small thing? Do you think this is little? You think this is okay? That you can just have the good of the land, the good of the people? And then you feed my people garbage? All right, let's hear about it. He said, as for my flock.
They eat that which you have trodden with your feet. They drink that which you have fouled with your feet. Therefore, thus says the Lord God unto them, behold, I, even I, will judge between the fat cattle and between the lean cattle.
He said, I'm a judge between the fat cattle and the lean cattle. All y'all, all of you pastors have been teaching garbage. Teaching our people Christmas. Wearing crosses. Going out here telling them to feed crackheads. Pray for crackheads. See here, that crackhead is your brother. It could be Jesus. Stop telling these lies to these people. Taking their money. The tithe, you robbing God if you don't pay these tithes. Why they go sit there and they buy their new house? Why they buy their mansions? They driving around in their cars. Talking about you can have it too if you give enough money. He said, I'm a judge between the fat cattle and the lean cattle. Let's hear about it.
Because you have thrust with side.
This
with
trumpet is blowing.
And pushed all the diseased with your horns.
Uh-huh.
Till ye have scattered them abroad. Therefore will I save my flock, and they shall no more be a prey, and I will judge between cattle and cattle. And I will set up one shepherd over them, and he shall feed them, even my servant David. He shall feed them and shall be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David, a prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken it.
That's the Most High God talking. That trumpet is going to blow. You people don't want to hear it, though. It's Colossians chapter 2. Only thing they want to talk about is they little holidays. Christmas is coming up. Let's start preparing for Halloween. They even got, you know, they in churches, they still celebrate Halloween. They try to turn it into something good. They call it the Autumn Festival, huh? Kids grow up. I mean, you can't dress up like a goblin. You can dress up like a fairy, though. Okay, that make a whole lot of sense. You can dress up like an angel. That make a whole lot of darn sense. It's Colossians chapter 2, verse 16. Our stuff in the book. When we talk about the stuff we celebrate, we appoint it to you right in the book. Nothing made up. It's in the book. Right? Keep going. This is Colossians chapter 2, verse 16.
Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holiday.
So how you going to judge me? Don't you ever judge me in respect of a holiday. Right? Our stuff is in the book. How are you going to judge me? If it's in the book, it's written. When it comes to day of trumpets, I can go right to it. We got a memorial, a blowing of trumpets. How are you going to judge me? Keep going.
Or of the Sabbath days.
Mm-hmm.
Or of the new moon, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is in the Messiah.
What do you say that woman told you when you was at work, baby? He told you, didn't she tell you the Sabbath was Sunday? She looked at you when she said, huh? Don't be judging me about no Sabbath. You're going to have a wrong day. Ain't nothing written about your Sabbath. And you're going to judge me about it. Don't look at me think you telling me something. You take your garbage somewhere else. Nobody want to listen to this stuff. Keep going.
Let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into these things.
Nah, we skipped something.
Wait. No, we didn't. Which are a shadow of things to come.
Oh, okay.
But the body is in the Messiah. Is of the Messiah.
Right? These things are a shadow of things to come. The stuff that we celebrate, they're a shadow of things. What do you think Christmas is a shadow of? Damnation. It's a shadow of. It's a shadow of you about to go to darn hell. A shadow of everything that the Most High God don't stand for. It's a shadow of darn darkness. How you got a shadow of darkness? Shadow is already dark. Time for our people to wake up and real wake up. Not this fake little woke stuff. I'm a real wake up. Wake up to the word of God. The book, grab verse, not one, you can give me about six. Colossians 2, verse 6. Watch this. Sometimes they'll use that, what we just read, they'll use that against them. As if they did something. I celebrate Christmas, I celebrate Sabbath on the Sunday, this, that, and other. The Bible say don't judge nobody according to stuff. All right, you right, it say it. Watch what else the Bible say, though. They don't never go back. Same chapter, right? I ain't just put this stuff in here. Same chapter, verse 6.
As ye have therefore received the Messiah, Yahushua, the Lord, so walk ye in him.
He said the way that you receive him, that's the same way you should walk in the man. When you received him, the man didn't tell you about no Sunday. He came to you talking about, I'm the Lord of what?
The Sabbath.
He came to you talking about the Sabbath was made for who?
Man.
So where y'all get the rest of this stuff from? He came to you celebrating what feast day?
Passover. All of them. Feast of week.
So I'm trying to figure out where y'all got all the rest of y'all stuff from. Books say the way you received them, that's the way you're supposed to walk in them. How are we doing something wrong? That's crazy. Keep going. Let's see.
Rooted and built up in him, established in the faith as we have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit.
He said, beware lest someone spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. Right? Through philosophy and vain deceit. I saw it. Christmas is what?
Vain.
It's vain. Is it really about God or no? That's deceit. If it came from a sun god, of which they used to worship by having a tree, chopping the tree out of, Jeremiah 16, is it?
Jeremiah 10?
Yep. It's Jeremiah chapter 10. Give me verse 2. I just don't want y'all to feel like I'm making nothing up. I mean, every Christmas, you're going to have a good tree that you chop down. Somebody going to chop it down for you, actually. You know, wrap that thing up, take it to Sam's Club and Costco. You know what I'm saying? That's where you get the good tree. My pop used to get the big old good tree. He used to go there, go to Sam's Club, Costco, you know what I'm saying? Get that thing, wrap that thing all the way up. You know what I'm saying? Get that thing wrap, put it on top of the car. You go through all this trouble. You go put that thing on top of the car, wrap it. He probably still do it. Wrap that thing onto the top of the car. And then you go and you drive, you know what I'm saying? You set that thing. That thing was the most amazing thing. And you set that thing up. And you put the little bolts at the bottom of it so it don't move. You don't want it to fall over or move. So you go twist it and put the little bolt, put a little bit of water at the bottom of it. Then you sit there and you just look at it. Then when you had a tree, you just look at it. Just you stand back and you just be like, that's a tree there. All right, that's a tree there. You know what I'm saying? You look at it, that thing felt good. Every darn morning until Christmas comes, you run down the stairs. You be like, do I got more presents under there? I mean, that thing was a big deal.
With the ornaments on there.
First you set up the tree. And the kid, we always wanted, let's decorate it right now, right? Parents be like, nah, you know what I'm saying, hold off a little bit, we'll decorate it soon. Then they bring out that box. You know it's home when they bring out that darn box from the garage or something, you know what I'm saying, or from the closet. Bring out that box, you open it up, you got all the stuff in there. You got the bulbs and all that stuff. Some of them broke. Somebody get a whooping, one of them broke. You know what I'm saying, you start putting them on there. That thing, you start wrapping it up. Then it's real good when they get that fake snow. You know what I'm saying? It's like spraying the fake snow. You know it's real good when you get that. So you got everything on there. And then at the very end, what you put at the top of that thing? You got an angel. You're a real Christian. You put an angel at the top of that thing. Right? But really, you're supposed to put a star at the top of that thing. Right? Why a star? Represent Jesus. Jesus the light.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about it.
Thus says the Lord, learn not the way
this
of the
heathen. This is Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 2. He said, thus said the Lord, learn not the way of the heathen.
And be not dismayed at the signs of heaven.
He said, don't be dismayed at the signs of heaven. You know why they have it at the time of the year? Is it because Jesus was born in December?
The winter solstice.
Different parts in the world, the winter solstice, got different signs that go on in heaven. Right? You can look in the sky and you can see the stars and everything. You fast trying to do something you ain't supposed to do, ain't you? Right? You look at that stuff and you start seeing a sign. That's how they knew it was the winter solstice, because they could look up. He said, do not be dismayed at the signs of heaven. Keep going.
For the customs of the people are vain.
They're what? Vain. I could have swore that was what we just read in Colossians. He said, stay away from vain philosophy. From philosophy and vain deceit. Right? Keep going.
The one cuts a tree out of the forest.
What does one do?
Cut the tree out of the forest.
Oh, that's crazy. He ain't gonna put no ornaments or nothing on it, though. Keep reading.
The work of the hands of the workmen with the axe.
Uh-huh.
They deck it with silver and with gold.
He put ornaments on it. They put the, you ain't never had them silver themselves. You know you have the gold ones now. You ain't never had the silver ones though. Them nice looking silver ones. Them things was usually in a different kind of box. You know what I'm saying? You had the box of regular old red ones and the green ones. That, you know what I'm saying? That's a regular box. But you had them real nice ones, you know what I'm saying, come in that special box. Man, that thing cost $4.99 a piece.
My pops used to have the silver and gold.
Man, I'm trying to tell you, you put that thing, because that's when your tree was nice. You got them silver. You can never put too many. Them thing cost too much. You know what I'm saying? You can go to a white person's house, son, that thing be decked out with the silver and gold. Or how you probably had, like, you know what I'm saying, three or four silver and gold. You have to make sure they all in the front. You know what I'm saying? You put them in the back, you don't waste them. Ain't nobody going to see it. You put it all in the front. They put silver and gold on it. He just read that. It ain't really in the Bible. You can't see it in your own Bible. That you're going to cut down a tree out of the forest and you're going to deck it with silver and gold. We just put that there because I haven't been there all these years. Keep going.
They fasten it with nails and with hammers that it move not.
You mean they've been doing this since ancient times? They've been screwing the bottom in there so it don't move? Go ahead, let her. Then they're going to make a fool out of it. They're going to say, that's not talking about no darn Christmas. That's before Christmas even started. You right?
Yeah, exactly.
That's the point.
They just gave it another name.
That's talking about a false god. Yeah, that's the point. What you did, or what you do every year around Christmas, and you think you celebrate something and worshiping God, come from worshiping a false god. The whole tradition. Everything that you darn doing, from the lights on top of your house to the gifts underneath the tree, to the tree itself, right? All of it comes from celebrating and worshiping a false god. Grab Colossians 2. Where do we leave off? 7, 8, 9?
18.
Well, 8. No, 8?
Yeah.
It's Colossians chapter 2, verse 8. Give me verse 7 again. Bless you. It's Colossians chapter 2, verse 8. Verse 7.
Rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving.
Uh-huh.
Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit after the traditions of men.
After what?
The traditions of men.
He said, do not learn the way of the heathens. He said, do not let anybody spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. That's after the way of the heathens, after the traditions of men. Keep going.
After the rudiments of the world and not after the Messiah.
He said, that thing is not after the Messiah. So now I'm trying to figure out what you got to say to me when it comes to the Day of Trumpets, when it comes to the Day of Atonement, when it comes to the Week of Ingathering, when it comes to Purim, when it comes to the Passover, when it comes to the Week of Unleavened Bread, when it comes to the First Fruit Sheaf Waving, when it comes to the Feast of Weeks. Right, what do you have to say? Our stuff is written. It's in the book. I'm not following nobody. Oh, y'all stand condemned. Keep going.
For in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily.
Mm-hmm.
And ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power.
Mm-hmm.
In whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, in putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of the Messiah. Buried with him in baptism, wherein also you are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God who has raised him from the dead. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, has he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses.
That's for all of us that represent and walk in them the way that we receive them. Not based off of some vain tradition that these people made up and these people been following and tried to switch up and try to make it seem like, oh, yeah, Easter, that's Easter. Sure, we have eggs, but that's about the resurrection. You cut to stop all that lying. You got nothing to do with no resurrection. Nothing to do with darn Ishtar. All this weird stuff y'all be celebrating. Stuff ain't got nothing to do with Lent. like celebrating Lent, putting a black cross on my forehead. That's crazy.
Y'all crazy.
Just worthless. The Lent in my darn pocket. It's Numbers chapter 29.
I was at a restaurant one time.
You be walking around, they freak you out, don't it?
I didn't know, though. Like, I didn't know what it was. I was looking. Why is this happening? Like, it started to scare me for a second. And I was like, oh, wait.
Crazy thing, I ain't never seen that thing in my whole entire life until I got
over. Yeah, I was like, wait a minute. Mm-hmm. I was like, I heard about this. I was like, wait. It took me a while to catch on. But when I saw it, I was like, oh. You remember that? We was at, what was that? Red Robin? That thing was kind of freaky, man.
Ash Wednesday. Oh, you know that ain't real. I was young. It was ashy every day. One time I was so ashy, I probably could have painted a darn cross on my darn arm. I used to be ashy when I was young.
Yeah.
That thing used to be crucial. I remember one time police came to our house. And it was a black cop. It was a black cop, and we just hanging out, you know what I'm saying? Me, Candace, you know what I'm saying? The police came to my house because of some foolishness. And so he was cool, though. He was keeping everybody calm and everything. So he walks in the room, and he is just checking all the kids and everything, and I'm amongst them. You know what I'm saying? And he looked down at me. He's like, hey, what are you doing? Whoa, boy, I thought you had on some darn socks. Them your feet. Oh, man, I was so embarrassed. But it was hilarious. I was like, you. That was a good one. I'll never forget that guy. That day was hilarious. He's like, boy, I thought that was your feet. You know what I'm saying? You ain't got on no socks. All right, go ahead.
Numbers what?
It's Numbers chapter 29, verse 1. Numbers chapter 29, verse 1.
And in the seventh month, on the first day of the month, you shall have a holy convocation.
Uh-huh.
You shall do no servile work.
This ours is in the book. You ain't gonna find no Christmas in the book. You ain't gonna find no birthday of December 25th of Yahushua in the book.
It is a day of blowing the trumpets unto you.
Mm-hmm.
And ye shall offer a burnt offering for a sweet savor unto the Lord. One young bullock, one ram, and seven lambs of the first year without blemish.
We had the sacrifice for all. Right? Grab Numbers chapter 10. Verse 1.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, make thee two trumpets of silver, and a whole piece thou shalt make them, mm-hmm. that thou may use them for the calling of the assembly and for the journeying of the camps. Mm-hmm. And when they shall blow with them, all the assembly shall assemble themselves to thee at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation.
Now listen to the reasons that the trumpet might sound. These are all the things that we have to think about when we listen for the trumpet.
And if they blow but with one trumpet, then the princes, which are heads of the thousands of Israel, shall gather themselves unto you.
I mean, you blow and it's just one trumpet. I'm just looking for the heads. You know what I'm saying? That's all. I ain't looking for everybody. I'm just looking for the people that's running the show. You know what I'm saying? The heads of the houses, y'all come on now. All right? Let's hear it.
When you blow an alarm, then the camps that lie on the east part shall go forward.
All right? You blow an alarm? Okay. Time for people to start moving out. Right? The east side, y'all got to go. All right, what else?
When you blow an alarm the second time, then the camps that lie on the south side shall take their journey. They shall blow an alarm for their journeys.
All right, so you have another alarm. Now it's time for the south to go. Let's see.
But when the congregation is to be gathered together, you shall blow, but you shall not sound an alarm.
Mm-hmm.
And the sons of Aaron, the priests, shall blow with the trumpets, and they shall be to you for an ordinance forever throughout your generations.
So who going to blow the trumpets?
Sons of Aaron. Priest.
Remember, we used to blow that trumpet, right? Don't do that no more.
Yeah, buddy.
Don't do that no more. You see a lot of the Hebrew Israelites, they be out here blowing the trumpet. Oh, that thing sound real good. So I'll be looking at it like, that thing sound real good. Y'all type with that thing. Ain't gonna be us no more. But clearly say, sons of Aaron. A lot of these guys, man, a lot of these guys, and we, you know what I'm saying, when we come in, who gonna teach? Nobody taught us this stuff. Right? So to some level, I understand the Hebrew. Out of zeal and everything, we sit here, we just trying to replicate and we trying to get back to our roots to try to live it, to make sure that we get back to it. We've been defiled with all this weird stuff all our life. So we just doing our best to try to get back to it and to try to best represent where we come from, to be proud of it, right? And to promote something different. So I get it. I understand. But a lot of these guys don't know no law. They don't know the law. They still learning the law. And if they sat down, they're like, eh, you know what? I'm still just learning the law. Let me down. And we probably can get somewhere. But, you know, they learned about a feast day, a Sabbath. They learned certain foods is unclean. That's the extent of the law. Oh, I'm an expert in the law. They don't know no law. Right? We have to be able to look at this thing, and we want to keep it 100%. Yeah, I can't make sacrifices. I can't blow the trumpet. I can't do none of that without a son of Aaron. What am I going to sit here and blow a trumpet for? That's crazy. Won't be me. No. You know what I'm saying? Won't be me. I imagine a trumpet. I'm waiting for it. Trumpet going to blow. You ain't got to worry about that. It's going to be a trumpet blown. Trumpet going to blow. When it blow, we just need to move. Everybody ain't got to be the man. Everybody want to be the prophet. You know what I'm saying? You got people on there, prophet this and apostle that. Everybody want to be a prophet and an apostle. Everybody want to be the man. Everybody, that's cool. I'm just trying to play my part. When the trumpet blow, I ain't even calling. It just blow one time. That's for the head. They ain't even. What I'm gonna walk up for? I ain't walking up nowhere. You know what I'm saying? I'm just waiting. I'm waiting for the alarm. You know what I'm saying? That alarm go. Let's go. East side, keep it moving. Let's go. You know, it blow twice. South side, let's go. It blow again. All right, west, let's get up out of here. Finally, north, let's go. You know, I like to believe I'm with Judah. I'm in the north. Right? Let's just move. Right? Even though Judah wasn't in the north when we was in the wilderness. Judah, I think, where was Judah? West or east?
I can't remember.
I want to say Judah was on the east. Might have been on the east. All right? But when we come back, Judah in the north. All right?
I said it could be because they went first when they went to go.
I want to say they was. Mm. I think it got some word and it was like towards the sun or something like that. But yeah, when we come back, Ezekiel told us Judah going to be in the north. You know what I'm saying? That's where I want to be. You know what I'm saying? We're going to be the last out. Right? That's what we have to look at. We have to just make sure that we understand the book and we continue to promote it, continue to be a light. And not promoting it as in promoting it, you know what I'm saying? Like trying to sell it to people, you know what I'm saying? I'm just mean promoting it by we live what the book says. And by that, the people that the Most High God is after going to see it, it's got patience. This stuff, that ain't nothing that you do for a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks or this, that, another. I'm talking y'all watching in that be texting me. It ain't something that you just do for a couple days, a couple weeks. Right? It's something that we got to stick with. We got to be consistent. That's what the Most High God is looking for, consistency. Somebody is not just going to do it. There's a whole lot of people in this book that the Most High God appeared to, he showed himself up to, and he didn't give them nothing when he showed up to them. He just told them what he was going to do for them. And they had to show themselves consistent before they got it. We saw that with Abraham, we saw it with Isaac, and we saw it with Jacob. Or we going to see it with Jacob, rather. All right, you have to remain consistent. You have to go through some things. And you still going to die before, well, a lot of us going to end up dying before the Most High God just to give you what you have promised. All right? We have to hold on to it by until death. That's faith. Any questions? Let's go ahead and pray out.